The world is changing and developing faster than you can imagine. It is hard to protect your company's assets against adversaries. We all know that lingering feeling that somewhere, something might still be a weak element. To discover what outsiders could do to your company, you have to be on the outside of your company. This is exactly how red teaming operations work. Red teaming originates from the army, where the red team was created to think, act, and behave like an adversary. In doing so, the red team simulate an attack to see how this army would respond and where they could improve their strategies. This way of thinking works perfectly in the protection of your organization. This protection is based on three core elements. The first element is the cyber element. The well-known cyber attacks, with these hackers trying to gain access to or disrupt a company. However, cyber isn't the only area of interest. A lot of companies provide easy physical access to their assets, a perfect starting point for a combined attack. The last element is easily forgotten, but may well be the most important, the human factor. Your company consists mainly of people who have both physical and digital access to your assets. Targeting them gives adversaries more chance of achieving their goals. With Deloitte's red teaming operations, your lingering fear becomes a confident feeling of security. You and your employees know your weak elements and how to react to an attack. So when a real attack does happen, you're prepared.
Da, am revenit cu prietenii noștri de la Deloitte. Mulțumim foarte mult că v-ați alăturat eforturilor CIO Council de a deschide perspectivele a ceea ce înseamnă securitate cibernetică către audiența proprie. Ați pregătit o prezentare foarte interesantă care aduce în discuție o dublă perspectivă, cea a atacatorului și a organizațiilor care se apără. Aș vrea și eu să fiu de partea celor care se apără, domnul Mihai Olteanu și domnul Adrian Ifrim. Aveți legătura.
Ok. Prezentarea va fi făcută în engleză, so I'll switch to English. First of all, just to introduce myself, I recently joined the Deloitte team, so I'm pretty new here in the team, trying to build this, we call it blue team, with the focus on different cyber detect and respond areas like identity, privileged access management, SIEM solutions, and so on. So that's me, and today we'll discuss in the first part of the presentation about the actual cyber threat landscape that we have right now all over in Europe. So just to begin, we have a couple of surveys that were conducted by Deloitte. And accordingly to these surveys, it seems in the last years, a lot of people, a lot of respondents have answered that the cyber threat is not actually changed so much as compared with the last years. Even though there are some changes, of course, and for example, companies like consumer businesses or energy businesses felt it more than the financial sector, because financial sector was somehow used with the cyber attacks. It was in the game for such a long time, and the cyber security maturity in financial sector is higher than compared with the other verticals. Anyway, the shape of the threat against all the industries has changed recently, because now it's not only about gaining some financial benefits, but also about destruction. We have state actors right now in the in the market, and they usually go for destructive attacks. So when we discuss about distractions or gaining some benefits, first step is to get a foothold inside the company, inside the organization. And there is some kind of top 10, some rankings regarding this kind of cybersecurity threats. And the most still the most let's say seen in the cyber attacks, it's still the phishing type of attacks, because after all, human factor will be always the weakest link in the cyber defense strategy. So because many businesses, especially in the financial sector, are dealing directly with the other people's money, it's natural that this sector has more attention than compared to the others. And unfortunately, half of the respondents have ranked this kind of attack, this kind of cyber threat, as being the top, the first one. A second biggest rank, we can say the technical vulnerabilities in the applications and infrastructure will be. But as you can see, it's a big gap between, big difference between those two. There are companies that usually delay the patching and the security updates because the unavailability risk is too high, and they prefer to have a proper change request process inside the company, which sometimes unfortunately takes a lot of time. And of course, hackers don't wait, and they can always strike. But anyway, this is also known as one of the biggest risks. And the third one would be data leakage, data integrity, which can lead to not only the company damage, but also accordingly with the latest regulations, with the big fines. And that's also a big impact in the companies. Now, we can discuss about the how often the cybersecurity is on the leadership agenda. So basically, one of the main issues in this world is that top management is not informed properly, or maybe the people are trying to inform the top management, but the top management is not giving the right attention to the security guys from the company. So accordingly with the statistics, only 42% of the companies, of the respondents, confirmed that they have weekly or monthly meetings with the top management, where they inform them about trends, about cyber risk, and so on. The rest, as you can see, are less, quarterly or twice a year or even once a year, which is very low, we can say, because if top management is not involved in the security landscape or in security threats that can pose a risk to the company, that will be a big issue when the cyber threat will happen, because it will happen. Now, another issue we can say in the cyber defense efforts is about the cyber resilience, which actually we can say it's implemented only if you follow all the four rules. So when we are talking about cyber resiliency, we discuss about having a strategic plan. We discuss about having an operational plan, and also we need to have cyber hygiene and awareness trainings in the company. If we don't have all these four, we cannot say we are prepared for an attack. So even if we have them, for example, if we have a we have the cyber cyber defense plan, but if we don't test it frequently, again, that means we are not prepared for the attack. And unfortunately, only 9% of the respondents have confirmed they have all these four cyber measures fully implemented in the inside the organization. The rest have either the just the defense plan or either the awareness training and so on. So that's again a very big issue in the companies right now. One thing to mention is a lot of companies think that they are well defended, and this false sense of security has grown, unfortunately, and studies show that the risk of the business overestimating their cybersecurity capabilities can lead to big impact when a cyber attack will happen. So if we look at the numbers, the positive self-evaluation also stands in contrast to the fact that less than 10% of the businesses, as we've seen in the previous slide, are actually implementing all the are fully implementing the baseline cybersecurity measures, response plans, self-defense plans, cyber awareness training, and cyber hygiene. So it's basically impossible to say you are well defended, you are cyber resilient, if you actually didn't implement all these cybersecurity measures. So it's a bit of contrast between these statistics. So for sure, somewhere the respondents haven't actually answered honestly about this. Now, from Deloitte perspective, we created a methodology, and we have a service portfolio that can drive your security operations in this evolving threat environment. We are based on a couple of new ways of doing this. I mean, a faster way by breaking out from the siloed approach to the threat to threat management. And this is how we actually divide the cyber attacks, actually. So right now, I will pass the microphone to my colleague to go for more technical details about how we can actually do this, how can we help the companies to detect and to respond to the cyber attacks. So, Adi.
Thank you, Mihai. To the organizers, thank you for your invitation. It's a pleasure to present in CEO Council Romania today. I've seen that there were a lot of attendees yesterday, and very good presentations. I hope to keep the same level. So I'm currently working for Deloitte Romania as a senior manager. I'm in charge of the offensive team. As Mihai described, we are now building up the blue team and improving our capabilities For those that do not know, Deloitte, besides accounting, does cybersecurity. And I'm proud to say that we have the biggest local team in the Big Four. And we have experience doing red teaming exercises, mostly in the financial sector. We've been doing these types of exercises for quite a few years, and today I'm gonna tell you about it. How does it look, and what is the outcome of such an exercise? As you probably know from recent attacks, and sorry to be in the way of the presentation, there are now more, the attack surface is getting bigger. I don't think it's exploded once the pandemic started. It started long ago due to adoption to new technologies like the cloud and migration to newer technologies like infrastructure as a code, Kubernetes and other types of technologies that only add more complexity to the already very complex infrastructures that clients have. So the SolarWinds attacks were mentioned earlier. This is only part of the supply chain. And what we are doing as a red team, we are basically discussing attack scenarios with our clients. We are replicating scenarios that are going to be executed by live actors in the future on their infrastructures, because it's not a matter of how, but a matter of when. And when we define this exercises, we basically take into account what is the generic threat landscape. And then we do also our homework. Now with the new legislation from the ECB for banks and the financial institutions, basically they understood the importance of threat intel prior to performing the actual red team. So we're getting to know our clients, we're getting to know their digital footprint, their weak points, their strong points. And then we define one or more scenarios and we execute them without any, let's say, deviation from the plan. This is how long it takes to do such an exercise. Of course, the time frames may vary depending on the actual dimension of the client infrastructure and the scope that is defined, the number of people that are being targeted, and the scenarios that are being developed. What is different from a penetration test is the fact that we work on live production systems. In order to keep this under control, we have daily status update. Communication is basically key. And we have key personnel assigned from the client to whom we talk every day. We have project coordinators, and also we have managers involved that have prior experience in these types of exercises. As you can imagine, if something goes wrong and it was not well planned ahead, we might actually end up in jail, which is a thing that we don't like. We have those get out of jail letters, we have agreements with our clients, and everything is carefully planned before launching such an advanced attack scenario. There are, of course, associated risks with testing in a live environment. The ECB has taken into account this type of things and actually came up with a cyber procurement guideline, which clearly highlights the importance of penetration testers and threat intelligence operators' experience. Clear rules of engagements need to be defined. You need to define red flags and you need to define actual breakpoints in the exercise. When the exercise has stopped, consider getting enterprise domain admin on your network. This, for some clients, is actually a stop point. We're getting access to the financial controller's account. We provide the full range of services, and besides targeted threat intelligence, red teaming, and now the blue team that we are developing, we are also offering purple teaming session. Basically, what they are sessions with the professionals from the client, that with the defenders, and we actually present the report. We present the indicators of compromise, how we managed to get in. Basically, we help them fine-tune their existing monitoring solution. Remediation and planning is the final step of the exercise. Sometimes we need to replicate the scenarios that have been executed. It's a more complex exercise than the traditional penetration testing. It requires quite a very good maturity, cyber security maturity for the client. And it's the next step in testing your cyber resilience. So basically, we look not only at the company when we decide to provide this type of services, but we look at what other clients are being targeted with. We look what has been accomplished by various threat actors, including state-sponsored attackers, and we replicate the exact scenarios, weapons, and tools. We mimic the exact and we simulate the exact procedures that they have. In very few words, this would be about it. Sorry for speaking so quickly. These are the purple sessions that I've been talking about. Sometimes we need to carefully disassemble every attack and recreate step by step the exact method that we've managed to get in. We use state-of-the-art technology. We have a dedicated laboratory and proprietary tools that we have developed over the years. So far, unfortunately, we have been able to bypass most of the cybersecurity controls that have been put in place in various infrastructures. There are some cases when we've got caught. The sad part of my job is the fact that I'm not able to disclose any details regarding those engagements. We do have even software and hardware specialized for these types of engagement. The remediation planning, the last step, requires close collaboration with every stakeholder in the company. And it's a continuous process for this type of engagement. The last slide on my presentation is how the actual teams are being set up. It's the attackers, the defenders, and the managers. The managers, as you can expect, the white team are from the client's team, and they provide and are responsible for managing the whole process and ensure the safe execution of the test. Basically, that would be it. The overall outcome of a threat intelligence based red teaming would be to increase the cyber resilience with Tiber, and I hope Tiber RAW will come in the following years. I think it will improve the whole health of the financial ecosystem, not just in Romania, but also at the European and worldwide level.
Thank you very much, Deloitte, for your presentation. Highly appreciated. Lots of information. I hope it is public. Just in a very, very short answer, how do you perceive the board of directors and the executives? What are their approach when it comes to the cybersecurity? Are they pretty knowledgeable? Do they understand the complexity of the cybersecurity? In very short answer. So do they support in general some sort of exercises to evaluate the cybersecurity level of maturity of the company, for instance? So are the boards and executive prepared for a ransomware attack?
What I can tell you is that at the European level, is that the clients that we are working with have above a medium cybersecurity maturity. And they have very good cyber strategies for the long term. And even, let's say, if the knowledge regarding cybersecurity technical details is not with the CIO, because that's not his job, they have very skilled people in CISOs and very good people in the blue teams and sometimes in the attacking teams, let's say the penetration testing or red team, internal red teams. But unfortunately, as everyone knows, there is a human gap regarding staffing in the cybersecurity sector, and it's very hard for private companies to keep such teams within internally.
Thank you very much, Deloitte, for Mihai Olteanu and Adrian Efrim for your presentation, and keep in touch.
Thank you also.
Back soon.
Bye.